Stuka Joe here, and today we're going to do a little demonstration of the CDG Solo Method, old and new. We're going to show you the mechanics of the old or original CDG Solo Method, and then we're going to show you the mechanics of the new method, so you can compare how both methods behave. Now, let's take a look first at the old method and the possible results and also the issues with the old method. Here we see the display for the original method. It has 7 spaces, a draw pile, a played or discard pile, and 5 spaces A, B, C, D, and E. Each of the spaces has a die roll range with a 1d6, which is the white die roll, and that's the general probability of that space being eligible, that card in the space to be played. So you see that A and E have 1 to 3, B and D 1 to 4, and C has the highest chance 1 to 5. Now, when playing with this method, a player selects a card that he wants to play, rolls the dice, and then according to the dice results, that card or some other card gets played. Now, we will demonstrate the possible results with Paths of Glory, and we place at the beginning of the game the cards, the draw pile, in the space here, and then we fill each space with a card so that each space from A to E has 1 card. And for purposes of this demonstration, I'm using the mobilization and limited war cards together, and I took out the Guns of August card, which the Central Powers many times as its first action round plays this card, and it is removed because it's an asterisk the event. So what we do is we start by flipping all the cards in spaces A through E face up. So here we see the cards, and let's say it's the first action round of the turn for the Central Powers. And you can see that the best card in terms of a chance of being actually played is this one, which is a weak 2-ops card. Actually, most of them are 2, just 1 is a 3. This one has a 1 to 3 chance. Let's say, for purposes of the example, that the Central Power nominates this card, Flamethrowers, to be played for its ops. So we have to roll 1 to 4 with the white die, and we roll both dice. The roll is a white 2, so it is within the range, so this card gets played for its ops, for its operation points. It is not removed permanently because it wasn't played for the event. It goes to the played pile. And now comes the cycling, which is typical in this method. If there's a card in space E, it goes to the discard pile, and all remaining cards, we slide them all the way to the right. So every time that a card that is not the E card is played, 2 new cards will fill spaces A and B. And that's one of the issues that people wrote a lot about, is the vicious cycling of cards. In one round, you've seen 2 cards go out, the one that was played and the one in space E. And if this happens during 6 rounds, we're talking about 12 cards going out and 12 cards coming in. So that's the first issue, is this excessive cycling. Now, you have to use a card counting mechanism. That's what these blocks are for. We played 1 card, so we move the 1 block to the played space. Now let's say it's the second action round, and we start by flipping face-up cards A and B. Okay, we see Tsar takes command. It can only be played for the event if this requirement is met. Let's say that the Central Powers want to play this card, German Reinforcements. It has a 1 to 3 activation range. So we roll both dice, and the roll is a white 4. So that is outside the activation range. So this card does not get played. And instead we consult the black die to tell us which one it is. It is the number 5 or E card, which gets played. So this card gets played for any allowable purpose. It cannot be played for its event because it's a combat event card. So it can be played for ops, strategic redeployment, or for purposes of replacement points. Let's say it gets played for ops. So the card goes to space E. And now the cycling is different. No cards move from space E because that's the card that was played. So we just slide the cards. And whenever a card is played, as you saw from space E, only one new card enters the display. So now, when we go to play the other side, there's only 20% uncertainty. You know 4 of the 5 cards. In the previous round, you would know only 3 of 5 cards. So the uncertainty was 40%. So here we see another issue is that the level of uncertainty always varies mostly from one card that you don't know or 2 cards that you don't know. So there's not a wider margin of uncertainty. And of course, the uncertainty is what makes these games so interesting. Now we have to mark that we played our second card, and we do so now. Now let's say we go to the third round. So we flip the card in space A. And here we see, look where the Tsar Takes Command card is right now, in space C, with the best chance of being activated. One of the other issues or problems that players commented was that players can manipulate the chances of activating cards just by letting them pass and waiting till they're in what we call the sweet spot. And this creates a game within a game, which diverts the attention of the player from the situation on the map. So that's another issue that we encounter here. Now, let's say now that we're going to the third action round, and now we want to play this card for its ops, and we roll 2d6. And let's further say that the Central Powers need 4 ops to plug some gaps or to resolve certain emergency situations on the map. So now we roll 2d6, and now the roll is doubles. And doubles under this method means a mandatory random event. And the mandatory random event that is associated to this result is the one in space D. So now the Central Powers cannot play this card, but now they have to play this card, Lyman von Sanders, with a operational value of 2 for its event. Now it cannot be played as an event because this is a combat card, so therefore it can be played for any other allowable purpose. So now the Central Powers has only 2 ops. And since it's played for its ops, it's not removed permanently, but now the situation on the map suffers because the card really doesn't address the need. So that's another issue, because this method is a way of selecting one card. You nominate one card, and either that card gets selected or another card which may not be relevant to the situation at hand. So this is the third card we played, and now we cycle the cards. And now the Tsar Takes Command goes from the nice C spot to the not so good E spot. And we flip and we fill the spaces with 2 cards. Let's go now to the fourth action round. And now let's say that we nominate that Tsar Takes Command card before it leaves, and it may take a while for it to return to the deck. It's a juicy 4 ops card. So we roll 2d6. And the roll is a white 5, which is outside of the range. So that card does not get played. The black 6 indicates that the card that will be played is the one from the top of the draw pile. So it's an unexpected card that we don't know what it is, and it is Libyan Revolt. So that means that this card has to be played for any allowable purpose. So let's say that the Central Powers will play the card for its ops, so it is not removed permanently, goes to the discard pile, but the Tsar takes command, leaves, and we slide the other cards. And this is another situation in which the uncertainty is going to be just one card when you play the card from the draw pile. And we played our fourth action round. Now, I flipped the card in space A. We would go now to the fifth action round, but I think I've covered all the possible alternatives. If you roll a double, it's a mandatory event, and if it's a double six, it's from the draw pile. But another thing, another issue this method has, which doesn't really apply with Paths of Glory, is that the method doesn't have a way to take into account different sized card hands. In some games, one side can have more cards than the other, and it's always these five choices that you make before you roll a die. So it doesn't really take into account that the larger side has more choices in terms of cards. So that is the other issue that was addressed. So now let's take a look at the new method and how it addresses each one of these issues and how does it work. And for that, we're gonna go now here to the side, and this is the display of the new method, which is, you can probably notice, footprint is considerably smaller than that of the original method. The new method uses just one die that has some sides, which we place some stickers, but it's just one die. And as a matter of counting cards, we use these chits. Every time a card is played, we simply flip the chit to its backside. When they're all gray, in the next turn we flip them to their yellow sides. And of course, card counting is always essential because not all CDGs are created equal, and you have to count the cards. Make sure you don't play more cards in a strategy or action phase than what a side has. Now, where do the cards go? We see here that the display has five spaces instead of seven, A, B, C, D, and E, and space C is a space from which we can play cards, but it doubles as the draw pile. So we place the draw pile here, and we place four Paths of Glory, which is a game where both sides have an equal number of cards. We place one card in each of spaces A, B, D, and E. And always we begin, you see those white spaces A and B, we begin with these two cards face up. So we're ready to go to the first allied action round. So let's roll a die and go through each one of the possible results. So instead of me rolling, let's just go through each one of the possible results. And we'll start with this result, A, B, C. We flip face up any cards face down indicated by the die. So we have to flip the C card. And this is the closest this method comes to the coin system, having a flip card on top of the draw pile. But now the player can choose any of these cards to be played for any allowable purpose. So you have a two, a three, and a three. Let's say the allies need to conduct some ops. They'll play this three card for its operational points. So it goes out, and notice that there's no discard pile. You just place it outside, and that's the discard pile. So we played our first card, we mark it here, and look what happens now. This card fills the place of space B. The uncertainty is now three out of five cards at the central powers. When you play the central powers, you don't know three of the five cards on this side. So that's 60% uncertainty. Now let's say the central powers played and we go to our second action round, and now we roll this result, CDE. So now we have to flip CD and E. And now all cards are visible. However, you can only play a card from CD or E. And we have 2, 3, 4. And one characteristic of this new method is that the cards that are cycled out are only the ones that you play, not any other card. So let's say that the allies still need more ops, so they're going to play this card, British Reinforcements, for its ops also. So it goes out, and Putnik goes to the E spot. Now the uncertainty has been reduced to 20%. Just one card is unknown, the one in the draw pile, which is always, let's say, almost always face down. So we played our second card. Now let's go to the third action round, and let's say the allies rolled this result, AB. Now the choices are from two cards. You saw that in the previous two results, you could choose from three. AB, you do not flip the card in the C pile, and you have to choose from A or B. And sometimes A or B is going to have low ops cards, and that's going to force you to choose a low ops card. And it is a simple yet effective way of having to play low ops cards. So let's say that they're going to play this card for reinforcements, which is an event with an asterisk. The allies play this card. This card is removed permanently from play. And that's our third card played. And now look what happens. We move a card to space B, leaving it face down. So now the uncertainty goes up to 40%, or 2 out of 5 cards. Now let's go to the fourth action round, and the other possible result, which is similar to that one, is DE. But now we don't have to flip any card in D or E, because they are already face up. We don't flip any card in space C. We have to choose from D or E. And let's say that the allies choose this card, wanting to leave Putnik in case they need it for some battle. It's a combat card. They play this card for the ops. So this card goes to the discard pile, which is outside of the display. And we played our fourth card. And now, uncertainty is 3 of 5 cards once again. Okay. Now we go to our fifth possible result, and it is this one. You see, it has a symbol, C, meaning that you flip the C card, and this is what it means. We flip the C card, and we have to play for the event the C card or any face-up card, and that's what this little symbol here means, face-up card for the event. In this particular situation, because we had two cards previously face up, we have three cards to choose the event. In the previous original method, you were stuck with whatever card resulted from the black die roll, which maybe didn't serve any purpose. Now, in this particular case, this card cannot be played for the event, so you'll have to choose between these two cards. Now, there may be a situation where none of the events are playable because the requirements are not met, or they are combat cards. In that case, what you do is that the lowest ops card, which is visible or face up, is played. So let's say this is the first turn of the game. You can't play any reinforcement cards, so none of these events are playable. So Putnik gets played because it's the lowest ops card. And that's another simple way of getting rid of the low ops card, ops cards that the original method didn't have. Okay, so let's say this card is played, and it's played for ops, so it's not removed permanently. And now we fill the spot with the card in space C. we still have 60% uncertainty. And we flip our counter, card counter marker to 5. So we have one, remember in Paths of Glory, there's 6 action rounds. So we still have 1 action round left and 2 cards left. We haven't shown any situation as to using cards in combat and how the other side can respond. I'm not going to show that in this particular video. Just want to give you the general idea how it works. Now, we go now to the 6th action round and we roll the last die result here possible. And this is the C with the Jolly Rogers. And the Jolly Roger symbol has a special meaning throughout the method. It can apply to what's called special cards. Now, there's no special cards in Paths of Glory. Special cards could be like in Twilight Struggle, you have a scoring card. Or in other games, Washington's War, Mr. Madison's War, you have mandatory cards. Here, when you roll this result, you only flip the C card, and you have to play the C card for any allowable purpose or the lowest ops card available. So in this case, it happens to be that both of these cards are equally low, so you can play any of these cards, the C card or the lowest ops. So in this particular case, you can choose from 3 cards, but in other instances, it could be that this is a 2 card and this is a 5 card. So you have to choose between playing your 5 card or playing the lowly 2 and saving this card here. But the thing about this particular method is that cards that go to these spaces never go away until you play them. So you don't have that risk that happened that we saw with the Tsar Takes Command, a really nice 4 ops card just leaving the track because it couldn't be activated. So this is the 6th possible result. And this is how the new method works. It gives you choice. It gives you varying levels of uncertainty that could be from 20% to 80% when you play the other side. So you're not going to know. Maybe sometimes it could be that you don't know 4 of the 5 cards of the other side or just 1. It also gives the player the ability with choice to make a better decision that will affect the situation on the map. And it eliminates the vicious cycling of cards that would have the effect that during mid-game, all you would see flowing through the track were the lowly ops cards. Now, this method also addresses the issue of varying hand sizes. In Paths of Glory, as I stated before, there is no such problem. But in Barbarossa to Berlin, there may be that problem. If the Allies capture what is known as certain resources, their hand size may increase. It could be many times 1 more card than the Axis. It could be 2 more cards than the Axis. And the Axis have a way of losing cards from their hand. Now, if we have a situation that we're going to begin an action or phase for the Allies, the Allies captured resources in the previous turn, and now they have 1 more card than the Allies. This is the way that you would set up the cards. Let's say that from the previous turn, let's say this was the situation at the end of the previous turn in terms of cards. But now the Allies have an extra card. So what you do is you place it in space A. If the Allies would have 2 extra cards compared to the Axis, it would go the second card here. See? Now let's say they have just 1 card for now. So the way that this works is, let's suppose that the Allies roll A, B, or C. So we flip both cards in space A and the card in space C. Normally, the Allies or any side would have 3 cards to choose from, but because they have the extra card, they have 4 cards to choose from. Now, if they would have rolled instead C, D, or E, that extra card doesn't come into play. So it won't come into play every time, but it has an effect on the game that it is available if the corresponding space is rolled. And let's say that the allies choose to play this card, Maki, and they play it for, I don't know, the ops. So it goes to the discard pile. And now the movement is always the card in the draw pile. If it's not played, it fills the spot, it goes here. So for the next action round, the allies preserve their plus one advantage in cards. So that's how this new method models having one extra card. Now remember, if the allies start spending cards in combat and you run out of cards, you can't play any more cards. You're stuck with one ops. And that's why it's important to be counting cards with the markers. If you don't count cards, you run the risk of playing more cards than the side actually has. Now, this in a nutshell is the gist of the new method and how it compares to the old one. I will be posting very soon the materials, the displays, the labels or stickers for the die in various sizes so that you can attach them or stick them to any six-sided die, and also the instructions, which are not long at all. I think it's one page for the die results. And of course, this is where I need help from my subscribers and viewers. Test it with your favorite game. I will be also making what I call tweak cards or player aids, 8.5 by 11 inch player aids, where tweaks for each of the games are stated. For example, for Barbarossa to Berlin, we would have to state that when the allies have, one side has more cards than the other, this is the way that you reflect that. For games that have special cards, like mandatory cards or scoring cards, that's where the tweak information will be located. And the idea is to have a general set of instructions, very simple, and then one page of tweaks for each game. Notice that this is a method that reduces the scope of choice to 2, 3, sometimes 4 cards, but mostly to 2 or 3 cards. And that makes playing the game easier because you don't have to burn your brain looking at all the cards, knowing all the cards on the opposing side to try to fool yourself. The level of uncertainty will keep things interesting. Now, this is new. I welcome your comments, your views, any way of improving it. Situations that are particular with various games, those will be handed through the tweak cards. And I hope to see you soon with a playthrough. I will be doing a playthrough of a card-driven game, one turn, where I will randomly be rolling this die and seeing what happens, and we'll take it from there. So, this is Stuka Joe, signing off for now. Thanks for watching.